Hey guys, welcome back to the Calibrate Tools channel, and today we're going to learn how to use one of these, a construction calculator. So stay tuned, and I'll see you guys right after this. Okay guys, so this is a construction calculator or a construction math calculator, and it looks like a regular calculator, but there are some very stark differences between this calculator and a regular calculator that you may use. And if you look closer, you can see some of the differences right on the keys or the functions. So down here, you know, it looks like a basic calculator here. You have the number keys, right? And then you have the, you know, division, multiplication, subtraction, and so forth. But then you get over here, right, and you see keys like this. What is that, an RCL? Well, that's a recall key, and that simply can recall the value that was previously in there. But the only way that this recall key will be of use is if you stored the value in the memory of the calculator in the first place, okay? And you do that with this button here, this M plus button, all right? This is a memory button. So for example, if I press 5 and then I press the M button, that adds that 5 to the memory of the computer. So let's just say I press on and bring it back to 0, right? I clear it and I bring it back to 0. I just simply have to press recall twice and the 5 comes up, right? Because it was stored in the memory. Now, what if you want to take it out of the memory of the calculator? Well, that's what this convert CONV button is for, okay? Now, that's just one of the functions that you can use this button for. For example, if you press convert memory, okay? Notice that there's a minus sign by the M here, okay? And let's just say you press 3. Now press the recall button about 3 times. And it cleared that value of 5 out of the memory of the calculator. Okay, so as we move on up the keyboard here, we start to see keys that are very useful to the tradesman, okay? We start to see what's called dimensional keys, right? And those are the keys that designate, for example, yards, feet, inches, millimeters, centimeters, meters, okay? So let's just say you want to enter a value of 7 yards. You would press 7, then yards. And you see the yard symbol right there. If you want to enter a value of 7 feet, you press 7 feet, 7 inches. There it is right there, okay? Now, you don't have to press the on-off button. You can actually convert or toggle between the dimensional units, right? So it's at inches now. If you press feet, that's what comes up, right? If you press yards, that's what comes up, okay? But it's based on the original value that you put in, right? So if I press 7 yards, okay, and I want to convert 7 yards to feet, I can just press feet and it turns to that, 21 feet, right? If I press inches, that's how many inches is 7 yards, right? So it depends on the original value and unit of measurement that you enter that will determine what the value of these other units of measurement will be. Okay guys, so what's this right here? That looks like a fraction bar key, right? If you want to enter fractions into the calculator, which you can very easily, right? So let's just say you're out in the field and you get a measurement of say 7 feet and 3/8 inches. You just enter 7 feet, okay? Then 3 fraction bar 8, and it automatically populates the inch value right there. So that's 7 feet, 3/8 inches. And you can also convert that to a decimal if you want to, simply by pressing the feet button and it turns to a decimal. And if you press the feet button again, it turns back to a fraction, okay? BDFT stands for board feet. Now, what is a board foot? A board foot is a unit of measurement for wood or lumber that's 12 inches wide, 1 inch thick, and 1 foot long. So to get 1 board foot, you would take those values of 12 inches wide by 1 inch thick by 1 foot long and divide that by 12, okay? That would equal 1 board foot. Now, lumber suppliers or sawmills use board feet to determine the right pricing for the lumber or wood material that they're buying and selling you. And you should know how to calculate board feet so you don't get ripped off or cheated as well. This is how you do it. Okay, so let's say we need 5 pieces of 2 by 4 by 8, and we need 10 pieces of 2 by 4 by 10. So let's start with the first one, okay? So we go 2 by 4 by 8, then convert board feet. So that's the board footage of a 2 by 4 by 8, but we need 5 pieces. So we multiply that by 5, and we get that, and we commit that to memory. Now for the second one, we type in 2 by 4 by 10, convert board feet. Now that's the board footage of that. So we need 10 pieces. So we multiply that by 10 and commit that to memory. Now we can get the total by pressing the recall button. And that's the total board footage of what we need, 93.33. Now, as of last week, the price of lumber was about $575 per 1,000 board feet. So let's just use that number for now, for the example, okay? Because we all know what's been going on with the price of lumber lately. So let's use $575 per 1,000 board feet, okay? So what we want to do is multiply the total board footage by 575. So we multiply it by 575, then press convert. Now, above this decimal point here on the keyboard, it says cost, C-O-S-T. Can you guys see it right there? Cost, okay? So we want to press that to get the cost. And that should be what it costs us for the lumber that we need. Okay guys, so let's jump to the stair button. Now this calculator helps you figure out the rise and the run of a staircase that you're putting in, or maybe one that's already in there. And it's pretty simple. But first, let's define, for those of you that don't know, what is the rise and run of stairs? Well, I made a little diagram for you guys here to explain that, okay? So the rise of a staircase is the distance, the vertical distance from the top of one step to the top of the next step, okay? That's called the rise. The run is the part of the staircase that you step on. It's also called the tread. Now, according to the code regulations in California, the minimum rise on a staircase or a step is 4 inches. That's minimum, okay? And the maximum is no greater than 7.5 inches. All right, that's why I got the 7.5, 7.5 right there. And the minimum run on a staircase is about 10 inches. Just for your information, you can check your own state for the regulations on that. Now the total rise is the vertical distance from one floor, the bottom floor, to the next floor, okay? That's the total rise, the vertical distance. I made it 36 inches for this example. That's about 3 feet. You know, because I got 3 steps here, but you know, of course it can be any length. Okay, so once you have your total rise, in this case, we're gonna use 36 inches. You can plug that into your calculator. So we go 36 inches, then we press rise, and then we press stair. Okay, and the calculator will give you the rise height, which is 7 3/16, okay? So we know that the rise height here, I got 7.5, but that's just the standard in California, but it's definitely over the minimum of 4 inches. So the rise height is 7 3/16. Then we press stair again. It gives us the number of risers. It gives us 5, all right? Then we press that again. And this is the riser overage or underage. Now, what is the riser overage or underage? That's the difference between the floor-to-floor rise, okay, right here, and the total height of all the risers, okay? Sometimes they don't match up, and the calculator gives it what it should be. So in this case, it'll be 1/16. Then you press steer again. That'll give you the tread width. We see it's 10 inches, and like I said, in California, the minimum tread width is 10 inches. Then we press steer again. It gives us the number of treads, says 4. Then we press steer again, and it gives us the tread overage or underage, and it said it should be 0, okay? Now the tread overage or underage is similar to the rise overage or underage, right? You have the total run, which is the distance from the first step all the way to the uppermost step, that horizontal distance that the staircase is gonna cover. That's the total run, okay? That doesn't always match up with the total run on each step, the tread width of each step, right? So the calculator is telling us that there should not be any overage or underage, meaning that the total run of each step should match the total run on the floor, okay, from the first step to the uppermost step. Also, it's worth it to note that sometimes you see steps where you have overhangs, right? You have overhangs here. They're called nosings. Nosings or overhangs are not included in the length of the tread width or the run of the step, okay? Then you press stair again, and you get the stringer length, okay? The stringer length is this right here. The stringer length is the diagonal support for the steps themselves, okay? And it gives you the length for what that should be. It says 49 1/4 inches, okay? And then you press stair again, and you get the incline. That's the angle of incline. So in this case, the angle of incline should be 35.71 degrees, right? And then you press stair again, and it gives you some stored values. Right? These are some stored values, right? That we may have had before. So that's what it can do for you. That's what this calculator can do for you when it comes to figuring out the rise and run of stairs so you can get your measurements right and all that good stuff. Okay, so the next button on the list that we're gonna look at here is the circle button, okay? That's the CIRC button. And what's great about that button is that by entering the diameter of the circle, it will give you the circumference of the circle as well as the area of the circle. For example, let's look at this pipe cutter here, and we wanna know what the area of this circle is and the circumference of it. Let's take our measuring tape and let's just say the diameter of this circle here is about 2 inches. So we enter 2 into the calculator, then press circle, and it gives us the diameter of 2. Then we press circle again, and it gives us the area, which is 3.14. Then if we press circle again, we get the circumference of the circle, which is 6.2. So this is very useful. Let's just say you want to put a column in the ground or a post in the ground, right? You need to dig a hole and you need to know how deep that thing goes. Let's use a utility pole, for example. A utility pole is around 40 feet tall and it goes into the ground about 6 feet. So the width of that is about around 18 to 24 inches as well, about 2 feet, right? So we're gonna have a column, let's just say utility pole, and this is the hole, this is the ground, okay? So it has to go about 6 feet down, right? 6 feet into the ground, and we gotta fill that hole with concrete. How much concrete do we need? So we would take the diameter of the post or the hole, which is gonna be about 24 inches. Okay, then we hit circle, and then we hit circle again, and we get the surface area of the hole, and then we multiply that by the height of the post, which would be, in this case, 40 feet. And then we hit equal. So it gives us in cubic yards the amount of concrete that we need to fill the hole, okay? So that's 4.65 cubic yards of concrete to fill that hole for the post that we're gonna put in there based on the dimensions that we have. Now above the circle button, you also have arc, which means you should be able to find arcs or the segments of arcs with this calculator as well. Okay guys, let's talk about the top keys here. These are called right angle function keys. You got the pitch, you got the rise, you got the run, diagonal, hip and valley, and jack. Okay, we talked about the rise and the run pertaining to staircases, but you can also use the rise and the run for, like I said, roofs, roof pitches, and things like that, right angles and so forth. Okay guys, before we go any further, let's talk about some of the basic components of a roof, okay, so we can understand what you're calculating when you're talking about hip and valley rafters and all that stuff, okay? So this is a diagram of a roof, and if you notice the topmost part of the roof, right? The peak of the roof, those are called ridges, see? That's a ridge, and that's a ridge. Extending off of the ends of the ridge, okay, these are the ends, you have these rafters. These rafters are called hip rafters, okay, hip rafters. So you have one here, you have one back here, that's a hip rafter. All right, then you also have what's called a valley rafter, right? The valley rafter doesn't extend off of the ends of the ridges like the hip rafters. The valley rafters extend or start somewhere in between the ends of the ridge. Okay, so there's one right here. Then you have what's called jack rafters. Jack rafters extend from either the ridge or the plate. The plate is the bottom part of the roof edge, right? That's the plate. Now, jack rafters extend either from the ridge and don't reach the plate, or extend from the plate and don't reach the ridge. So here's some jack rafters extending from the ridge, hitting the valley rafter. Here's another one hitting the valley rafter. So the jack rafters get intercepted by another rafter before hitting the plate, or vice versa. They can be extending from the plate and not hitting the ridge, all right? Then you have what's called common rafters. They extend from the ridge all the way to the plate. But they're not hip rafters, because hip rafters extend from the ends of the ridge. Unlike jack rafters, common rafters extend from the ridge and they reach the plate, or vice versa. Once again, like I said, jack rafters, they extend from either one, but they don't reach the plate or the ridge. Common rafters extend all the way from the ridge to the plate and vice versa. Okay, so let's apply this to the calculator. So let's just say we have a span of 20 feet. Okay, that means from one edge of the roof on the outer plate, okay, the bottom plate, to the other end of the roof's bottom plate. That's the span of the roof. Let's just say it's 20 feet. So let's type in 20 feet and then let's hit run. Okay, so run is another term for the span of the roof as well. So pitch is the amount of rise for every 12 inches of run. Okay, so let's just say it's a medium-sized roof, and the amount of pitch for a medium-sized roof is between 4 inches of rise for every 12 inches of run to 9 inches of rise for every 12 inches of run. So let's just say it's around 7 inches of rise for every 12 inches of run. So we'll type in 7 inches, then we'll hit pitch. And from there, we can press all these other functions to find out what their values are. So we can press rise. It gives us 11 feet, 8 inches high. The run, like you said, 20 feet. Diagonal, those are for the common rafters, and those are 23 feet, 1 7/8 inches. The hip and valley rafters, those are 30 feet, 7 1/8 inches. The jack rafters is 16 inches. Now this button here that has the R/wall on it stands for rake wall. And it finds the stud sizes for certain right triangle values that you enter into the calculator. And I think it also finds on center spacing as well. The weight button is pretty straightforward. You can enter in a value, let's just say 16, and press weight. And you can see the different volume values that come up, like this is kilogram, right? If you press weight again, you have ton, right? If you press weight again, you have pounds. And if you press it there, you have metric tons. So you can enter in a value, a volume value, or convert that value as well. Okay, guys, I hope you learned something today about construction calculators. I know I did. If you like this content, hit the like button to help spread the message, and subscribe so you can come back and get more of this great content. See you guys next time.